Meet the family, my friends, are your friends too. Take my own life and rebuild it. Round you.
This is Hourglass, a tribute to Nick Talbot and Gravenhurst, his musical alter ego. For over a decade, Nick produced wonderful, dark, spine-tingling, emotional music before his tragically early death at the age of 37 in December 2014. I'm Richard Pitt, and in the next hour, we'll feature tracks from the sessions I was privileged to record with Nick over the years. We'll have contributions from friends, fans of Nick's music from all around the world, plus musicians and respected broadcasters, and Nick himself.
My name's Julian Owen. I met Nick when I was a journalist for Venue magazine, commissioned to write a feature ahead of the release of Flashlight Seasons. Met Nick in the Cadbury pub on Richmond Road in Montpellier. The only stuff that I had access to at that point were on his website. He had on Silent Age website there were about three tracks. There was a Diver and there were a couple of others. I can't remember what from the first album.
It's getting darker and I'm still swimming. It hits me again. Still swimming, it hits me again, and I'm never frightened. No, I am never afraid, and you.
Bonded over music originally, but then found we just had a lot of shared interests. One of the people that we bonded around was a love of Richard Thompson. It hits me again. He was a definite hero to Nick, and someone who I think emulated in the best possible way, and they're both really seriously strong guitarists in the way, you know, unmistakably great. It hits me again. But also incredibly distinctive singers. And I'm never frightened. No, I am never afraid. And you will never understand the depths I sink to light your. The ghosts of autumn meadows walk me home. See the girl on the shore. It's my ID.
My name's Sophie Harris. I'm a music journalist and a friend of Nick's. I remember catching the train from London to Bristol, and I remember listening to his album Flashlight Seasons, which came out, was reissued on Warp in 2004, so this was 2005. And I just remember sitting on this train as it was zipping across the countryside, and it was winter and extremely bleak outside, and there's sort of mist moving across the fields, and it was just absolutely the perfect kind of visual accompaniment to the kind of music that Nick was making at the time, which was this very kind of desolate, fragile, rather dark folk music, at the same time really full of heart. My ID. And it was beautiful, and I was extremely curious to meet the person who was making this music. And I remember after the interview, which went on for hours, as I remember leaving and getting the train home as the light was beginning to fade and turn blue. And I just, you know, remember smiling to myself on the train and thinking, well, that was lovely, wasn't it? Wow.
I think probably the best thing, Nick, is just to play one. Do you fancy with or without reverb?
A bit of reverb on the voice would be good. Okay, let's see what we can find. What are you recording onto?
Minidisc and CD.
Groovy.
The first time I recorded a session with Nick was in 2002 for Bristol Uncovered, the programme I presented with Gary Smith.
And then I don't know about the guitar with reverb, but I don't know. I mean, live I'm actually playing electric guitar most of the time now, because it's actually a bit easier to play. But I put a lot of sort of reverb and delay on it and stuff, but... Okay, so I'll just start playing then.
Cool, that is big.
Is it?
Stereo hall. Is that too big?
Millennium reverb.
Yes. Well, yeah. We'll try it, see what you think.
My memories keep me feverish and sane. The night alive with stars and signs I can't explain. I recall an autumn fall, but I'll call a shutdown cinema. Never the same. This way, always never the same. This way, the world versus itself. It's them and us. There's no one else. Shoot a glance across the room. Lightning strikes, no one moves.
You're listening to Hourglass, a tribute to Nick Talbot and Gravenhurst. Nick grew up in Surrey, where amongst his friends was Rob Barneville.
I used to go around his house after school every day and we'd play guitar and we'd listen to music and we'd talk about bands and taking over the world and being in our own band one day maybe. And years later, we both moved to Bristol to go to university and we did form a band. We formed Assembly Communications. I remember one particular show we played at the Fleece and Firkin. And we supported The Fall, so we turned up, capacity audience, rammed to the rafters, and it was really good. And then Marky Smith appeared at the back of the room, and he jumped up onto the bar, and he walked down the bar from one end down to the stage, kicking pint glasses at the audience. And then he did something else on the floor for a bit, dribbling and mumbling, and then he left, and that was the end of the gig, and it was like, it was awful. Most people left, and people were saying it wasn't for the support band, they would have wanted their money back. And then the press the next day was saying that Assembly Communications upstaged The Fall, and it was just like, it was the best kind of publicity any up-and-coming band could ever have.
Unfortunately, just as Assembly were really having a bit of attention from the music press, came the tragic news that Luke had been killed. Decided it was too hard to carry on, and so that was to become, well, the end of Assembly and the beginnings of Gravenhurst.
I haven't actually played a guitar in front of anyone for about a year.
He played, you know, lots of old Assembly songs, which I think he did later on. Yeah, like Bluebeard.
Bluebeard was always a special song to me. I think I'd always loved it before I'd even joined the band. And it was just actually a brilliant pop rock song.
I've forgotten the words.
See what he meant?
Feel hollow, and you can decide which path to follow. You dig your own hole. Are you coming out tonight? We're going for a drive. The answer's in your eyes. The voice inside your head said, stay at home instead. Demons that thrive inside, a tale left half told. Wouldn't you love to know how the person inside survives? Is it any wonder you get so tender?
Alongside his music, Nick's interest in writing drew him to the Subversive Choke Collective, whose number included Adam Burrows from Bristol band Big Joan.
We brought out a compilation CD which had one of his tracks on it, which of course forced me to listen to the music, which then I thought it was a pretty good song. But we were like, you know, sat in Stu from Ivory Springer's flat, you know, just stuffing magazines with CDRs that we'd burn off on the computer and that kind of thing, and then just sort of sneaking them into record shops and putting them on the racks and that kind of thing. So that's really how I got to know Nick. And I suppose from a musical point of view at that time, I was more interested in what he was doing with Guy as Bront, because that was more up my street.
Hi, my name is Jeffrey Alexander. I live in San Francisco, California. An old band that I was playing in called the Iditarod shared a stage with him at the Cube in Bristol.
There's a war on, so I've got to stop playing a harmonica.
We hit it off immediately, and I ended up booking his U.S. tour a month later. Nick and I traveled around the East Coast of the United States for about 2 months, on and off that spring, and we shared a lot of stories and a lot of music, and became quite close. And Miriam Goldberg, who was playing cello in the band at the time, her and I were just starting a personal relationship more than just bandmates. And Nick was there for the beginning of that relationship. So I have a lot of fond memories of the three of us joking around. As we kept in touch over the years, our relationships all grew together. So I think about him a lot, and especially now as Miriam and I are married now, and just this year had a baby boy, Eugene, and I wish that Nick could meet him. A year later, Miriam and I went back to England and stayed with Nick in Bristol, and we did some recording. We were at his apartment, and we were all set up, and Miriam was playing cello. I was playing electric guitar, kind of like crazy freak out kind of guitar, and Nick took all of that stuff and added it to a song that he was working on called Black Holes in the Sand.
In the small hours I realize what I have done. In the small hours I realize what I
I went along to see him, and it was still very much of the thing of Nick's playing a show, he's my mate, go and see him. They did Black Holes in the Sand, which I'd never heard, it was brand new, it hadn't been released. And I just, you know, jaw hit the floor, just thought, wow, what an amazing song.
And I could not feel the flower in my hand.
Hi, I'm Lauren Laverne from BBC Six Music. I first heard Nick's music in the early noughties. It would have been about 2003, 2004. And it was Black Holes in the Sand was the first track that I heard. I have to be honest, it's still my favourite Gravenhurst track. There was a lot of very beautiful kind of atmospheric music that blended folk elements, kind of pastoral elements and electronic elements at the time. And so actually, texturally, there was a fair bit of stuff that was around that was not dissimilar to that, but at the same time, there was nothing like it. It was one of those instant spine-tingling moments where, you know, you hear a song and it just absolutely stops you in your tracks, and you have to hear more. You have to find out who is this? Who's made this noise? It feels new and it feels familiar at the same time. That's what he did so wonderfully, I think, especially with that EP and that track. You can hear it, this kind of blend of gorgeous kind of pastoral folk influences, but at the same time it's got this real kind of darkness to it. There's something very kind of menacing. There's this great piece that I read that talked about in The Quietus, who he wrote for, that talked about him opening up the doors of kind of time in his music. It feels like it exists outside of all those things, and all the doors are open, and any of those influences, any of those things can come in. You know, it can be kind of 60s folk, but it can be very much of its time. And that, you know, I can kind of hear influences of
Tinder Sticks, and obviously being based down in Bristol, the sort of sound that was around then in the 90s and early noughties. It's such an amazing record.
That's Lauren Laverne and her memories of Black Holes in the Sand, which was actually the first thing that Nick released on Warp Records.
I'm James Burton and I'm the label manager at Warp Records, and I worked with Nick Talbot throughout his career whilst he signed the label. Although Nick could be seen as perhaps more of the singer-songwriter, I think Nick also was very keen on experimenting and pushing different sides of his music, so he's very influenced by drone stuff, by psychedelic stuff, and a lot of electronic stuff.
Nick chose to record his new album with Ali Chant.
He was just really excited to get into a proper studio and be able to do something with something approaching a budget, because, you know, he had to work in a DIY way just for financial reasons, as much as anything, for most of his music career, really. Probably took about 2 or 3 weeks, which seemed like kind of a luxurious amount of time to me at that point, because I'd been used to doing anything with any budget really at all. I guess I was starting to work on some cool albums, and probably we'd been kind of like checking each other out from afar, like, oh, it'd be good to work together at some point, and that was sort of the opportunity, really, you know. I think the minute you got a deal, it was like, right, I'm going to a studio and I know which one it is and who I'm going in with, you know. We recorded to tape as well, which was something we'd never done before.
Felt like a logical thing to do with that band, actually. It also showed that with Nick's songwriting ability, you can have this sort of post-rock sounding thing with these great songs and this great voice in the middle of it. Hearing them play Velvet Cell in Soundcheck, first new song in a while, it's quite a departure at that time. And I remember him finishing it and Nick saying, yeah, what do you think of that one? It's a new one. Yeah.
Cool. Before I moved to Bristol, so I didn't know him at the time, but my band, you and the Atom Bomb, were just beginning to talk to Sink and Stove, and obviously Sink and Stove were involved in early Gravenhurst, and so I sort of mentioned that to him after his show, but didn't know him. But that was around the time that Fires in Distant Buildings came out, and that album, when my band, we all moved down to Bristol at the same time, and that was on heavy rotation in our house. And I do remember, actually, when my grandmother died, it was one of Nick's songs off that album that just kept going round and round in my head, and so listening to that at that time formed these really quite strong sort of links to his music in my head. And I once told him that, and he was really sort of embarrassed.
I live on both sides of the mirror. Feel the pain that destruction brings. I want to help put everything in its place. I want to destroy everything. There are cities underneath cities, cities beneath the sea, in deserted towns and burial mounds. There is beauty that no one will see.
Nathaniel Cramp is a music journalist and runs shoegaze label Sonic Cathedral.
I used to work at NME, freelancing as a sub-editor, and one day I heard I guess it was a promo of the Western Lands album on the office stereo, and the song Trust, for some reason, made my ears prick up and thought, oh, what's this? I don't know why I thought it was Brian Jonestown Massacre or something like that, and you know, found out what it was and got a copy of it and worked my way back.
I had no idea I was your anticipated mistake. I had no idea we were dancing on someone's remains. Can you please not like me? Would I see him in a crowd and give him his love?
Western Lands in particular kind of ticked all my musical boxes. And it's not really a shoegazy record, but it's got elements of that. It's very melancholy, and I like to wallow in misery. It's got a sort of folky thing, and you know, just all those elements combined, it just, you know, connected with me completely.
You have no idea just how it will feel until it happens to you.
Once asked Nick to perform Song Along the Pine when he asked if there were any audience requests. He responded by telling me that he'd need at least 8 other instruments on stage to make it sound good. It felt a little bit shunned, but looking back now, it's a fond memory.
Yeah, I was asked to compose music for a German film called Ein Freund von mir, which is directed by a guy called Sebastian Schipper. And the lead role in it is a guy called Daniel Brühl, who's quite well known now because he was in The Educators and Goodbye Lenin, and this is the film that he was involved in afterwards. So we thought this would actually do quite well because there was all this big talk about kind of a new wave of German cinema, but it hasn't actually been released outside of Germany yet. But they wanted me to do music for it, but I was on tour a lot, but I only ended up writing one original track for it, but they used a lot of stuff off the old album of Fires and Distant Buildings in the end. So that all worked out quite well, but I wrote this track whilst I was living in a caravan in Canesham. It was freezing cold. It sounds very romantic, but to be quite honest, it was absolutely dismal. But I got a couple of the right tracks out of it. But I haven't really played this live much, so we'll see what happens here anyway.
Just the way the fire.
hunger in the streets. It's just one way a broken city breathes. Could I smother the fire? Could I smother the fire?
My name's Phil Rickman and I'm a crime writer. I could see that lots of Nick's songs were about crime, mainly a kind of urban anarchy, the depth of evil on the streets, and the hunters and the hunted and the killers and the psychopaths out there. But the music is deceptively beautiful. It's not at all like the subject matter. I mean, one of his most perfect compositions, Song Among the Pine, is about a man, a fugitive from the cops, hiding out in pine woods. And you just know that the cops don't want him for shoplifting. But it's also wistful and catchy. Another of my favourites is one called Nicole, which sounds superficially like a romantic love song. And then you, once you listen to the words, particularly the kind of chorus which goes, "Oh, Nicole, from the moment we met, we let it get out of control." And then you realise it's about two dangerous people who come together. People who bring out the very worst in one another.
Find me the captain, tell him I want to know. Just who is steering and who's merely holding on. Last wave, I'll track him downwards to the engine room, and never let go.
Hello, this is Gideon Coe from BBC Radio 6 Music. It's very difficult to choose one song, but I've gone for Hourglass, which is found on Western Lands. It's one of the songs he played in session with the band back in 2007. I put the LP in my top five albums of the year in 2007, and he got in touch soon afterwards to say thanks, and I'd just like to say thanks to Nick.
In that first sort of two-thirds, I already thought, my God, this song is beautiful. Wow. And then in that last third, when it changes into a different musical phrase, and it was one of those moments, I'm sure we've all had listening to certain records when it changes unexpectedly into something just almost even more beautiful, and you just think, wow, I can't believe you just did that. And it has this beautiful kind of wistful quality that makes me think of John Hughes movies as well. And then the other part of it is that it was about him making trips to London and that whole part of his life, which, you know, makes me think of hanging out and spending that lovely time.
This is a song about London. It's called Hourglass. It's kind of about, what's it about? It's kind of about the allure of London, but the problems with it too, and kind of confusing emotions about people you might have who live in a certain place, and kind of confusing them with the places themselves, and the way in which, you know, the sort of the physical landscape and geography of a place can be so sort of imbued with emotional resonance that it makes it quite hard to go back to certain places. It's kind of about that. But on another level, it's just about getting drunk in London and ending up on the wrong train. So yes, it's actually quite a straightforward song, really. Here we go.
Thank you. stop and turn the hourglass again. The past is a strange place. I want it back, but just won't wait. City girl, what have we done to ourselves? City girl, what have we done to ourselves? Black spine, northern line, feeds on money and time. You cut your soul to fit. Battle scars from all night bars. Never thought that I would be so drawn to it. City girl, what have we done to ourselves? City girl, what have we done to ourselves?
Getting to the end of the hourglass and then, you know, popping it over and letting the sands run through all the way over again, and how we sometimes do just want to sit in a particular moment or memory. And it was, and still is, certainly not lost on me that that's what the song's about, and that when I listen to it now, I find myself doing just that.
How can I walk into my world?
Hourglass from the session we recorded in 2007. Now, you know how it is when you're a teenager and you get an obsession with a band. Mine actually was David Bowie. Nick's was Slow Dive, something he had in common with Nathaniel Cramp.
Slow Dive were one of my favourite bands when I was a teenager, and you know, I sort of always held their music with me, and Nick was similarly obsessed with Slow Dive. Used to send emails of obscure Slow Dive tracks that Neil didn't even remember writing or recording. Nick wrote this blog in 2009, passionately explaining his love for them. He ended his blog post with the classic line, "The young generation of fans have grown up and are settling old scores on the band's behalf, and we will win, you know." I had mutual friends that knew Michelle Hilborn, who was Nick's manager. I ended up speaking to her and asking about the possibility of maybe doing a gig with Gravenhurst at some point. It just didn't happen for various reasons until a couple of years later, when finally we got him to support Neil Halstead, a gig at St Giles Church in central London. Nick did a solo set, if I remember correctly, with an electric guitar. And, you know, just something about the setting in front of a stained glass window in sort of semi-darkness, it's just quite stunning. And then Neil went on and played some slow dive songs, so it kind of, you know, it was quite an emotional evening, I guess.
You're listening to our tribute to Nick Talbot and Gravenhurst. It's called Hourglass, and it features his friends and musical admirers.
My name's Paul Smith, and I'm the singer in Maximo Park, as well as with my own stuff. In 2010, I put a record out called Margins, which was my first solo album away from Maximo Park. It was more intimate. So when I was wanting to put together a tour, I approached Nick. He became the support act for my entire European tour. He came out and played the shows with his electric guitar and a few different pedals. But ultimately, it was him going out before we played and not just warming the crowd up with his brilliant songs, but also creating a mood where I could come on and play my songs that were quite different from the band that people were perhaps expecting. It was a time in my life where I was feeling quite unsure of myself and whether I'd done the right thing, even though I knew deep down that I had to do it. It still felt to me like, you know, what are people going to make of it? And he was there in the very first sound check in Oxford. It was just amazing to think that, you know, this guy that I knew quite well, but not really well, had come along and in the sound check was kind of shouting, "It sounds great," to us on the stage. And after the sound check, he was going, "It's going to be great, it's going to be a great tour." Although he was full of his own doubts, as every musician is, he really helped kind of bolster my own confidence. And to hear kind and positive words and encouragement from him really meant a lot at that time in my life. So it felt like the two of us were connected from then on in.
I seem to recall him coming in for a day on maybe a couple of occasions and just doing some demos in Toy Box, just with a, you know, just guitar and vocal, just a little bit like a radio session. That wasn't that long after Western Lands, and he already had the prize and one or two other tracks.
Every time you come around.
But then it seemed to take forever to get the rest of it written.
The warning sign in my head just gets stronger. Waves of anticipation, breaking vows as I make them, to chase that dream just one last time around. Chase that dream just one last time around.
The confidence that you had to do a departure like that, rather than think, okay, this is what the people who've supported me like, I'm going to do this, and with things being precarious as they were, it just wouldn't enter his head if he was making a new album to do anything but what he was, the direction that he felt compelled to go in at that time. So he did, and so we're left with this wonderful atmospheric record that I think draws on so many things, but certainly his love of Joy Division comes out there probably more than any other record.
Still the ties that bind us, blind us to the emptiness of the prize, of the prize.
We were hanging around a lot either side of fires and distant buildings and a little bit into when he was doing Western Lands, but then I sort of didn't see him as much after that point. But we'd done these initial demos of the prize.
You make the calls, I keep my eyes to the ground. In waves of anticipation, breaking vows as I make them, to chase that dream just one last time around. One last time around.
a poisonous glow, a poisonous glow.
I'm Claire Adams and I played drums and sang with Nick from April 2012.
My name is Rachel Lancaster and I played in Gravenhurst between 2012 and 2014. The first time that I met him was in the middle of the night on the tour bus to play heading to Amsterdam. So it was a pretty surreal experience.
Oh yeah, it's like he'd just been beamed in, wasn't it?
Yeah, just airdropped.
Airdropped all kind of dishevelled and slightly confused. And yeah. The story's headed in a very Nick way. But yeah. But yeah, no, we, you know, instantly just, I kind of, yeah, realised that it was all going to be all right.
He seems to really thrive off, like, playing together. Like, I think he really enjoyed practices.
Yeah.
And he was always, like, fiddling around with his pedals and, like, showing us stuff.
Took a lot of pleasure in kind of, you know, pulling some new pedal out of his bag and, yeah. And talking about it for half an hour solid.
So we've heard from a lot of Nick's friends, we've heard from fans, and a lot of them have chosen their favourite songs by Gravenhurst. But there was so much more to Nick than just his music.
I would send him a really, really long email in the daytime, and then he'd reply like 12 hours later in the middle of the night. And then it would go on for several days, you know, and they would be really massive, epic conversations, which would, you know, cover just anything that the two of us were interested in.
He wasn't one for a throwaway email. He was very much one for an essay on whatever you were talking about. I still, all the time, think about things that I want to talk to him about. Not long after he died, I was forever opening an email to write and then remembering and not being able to, and that was really tough for a while. But I really, yeah, really valued the sort of conversations with him. It was just so interesting, sometimes to the point where he could be borderline obsessive about things, but then things that you wouldn't necessarily expect. Like, he would go off on one about the most bizarre topics that you think, how on earth do you know this much about everything?
One thing that I really loved about Nick was, despite his incredible ambition for his own music, it was only ever as pop music to him. You know, he would talk, we both talked about our love of Aha.
George Orwell and, like, dubstep. He liked the really sort of nasty, aggressive stuff that nobody else was really talking about, but that what people actually listened to in the clubs a lot of the time.
Very, very quickly, he was an absolute connoisseur of the local dubstep scene. Of, okay, this person is really inventive, this person is a copyist, but it's kind of all right. Don't go and touch that. He was absolutely on top. He was just endlessly curious about music.
Despite his music seeming very much like it came from a very specific place, his interests were much, much broader. Bonded over a love of horror films. There was one called Slugs, where I think they'd used all of the budget on one massive greenhouse explosion and the rest of the film was just dire.
He seems to be the sort of person who had a lot of real friends, that everyone you speak to had a different take on him and a different relationship with him that probably in its own way felt quite intense. I didn't spend time with him personally, you know, regularly really, but when you did, you'd have really long conversations and it would be quite rewarding because you're talking to somebody that had a great brain and a unique way of looking at the world.
Closing time in the gardens of the West, and from now on an artist will be judged only by the resonance of his solitude or the quality of his despair.
He told me about it before I'd heard it. And he was describing a song called The Foundry and how he was proud of it. Thank you. write a song about the Holocaust and not make it terribly trite or insultingly banal.
Two black wolves chase a white tail through the snow into a ring fence, there's nowhere left to go. For purity and industry, for the gathering dust on aspen leaves, I'm watching wolves chase a white tail through the snow.
The chorus, he said with his fantastic laugh.
You won't know when,
you won't know evil, when comes. Evil comes, evil looks just
evil
like anyone.
Just like anyone.
I blame anyone but me.
Anyone but me.
That's the song that he was proudest of.
You let them burn books, you let them burn bodies. The man with the match could be anybody. A uniform changes something inside. Holding a gun makes you feel so alive. And everyone else is doing it too. It's alright.
You're listening to Hourglass, celebrating the life and music of Nick Talbot. Alongside his music, Nick had a great passion for writing. He wrote for The Quietus, and on a personal level, he had his own blog, The Police Diver's Notebook.
Police Diver's Notebook was just kind of that was weird. It really was the depth of Nick's imagination. I think that's the stuff that if he wasn't writing an email to someone at 4 o'clock in the morning, then he'd write something on there.
No matter what I tell you about Joseph Turner's depiction of boats docking on the Thames, no matter how sophisticated my description of his extraordinary renderings of colour, or how nuanced my meditation on the reflections of light bursts on the ship's beams, no words can put anything like it into your mind if you haven't seen it yourself. I may as well be describing custard.
He's incredibly literate and intelligent, fiercely intelligent, but an incredibly self-effacing and funny. Just, you know, someone who almost cares too much, if that makes sense. You know, he was concerned about other people's goings-on and things, and, you know, just sort of really cared about everything. All the other stuff that he did aside from his music, like his blog and stuff, he's just endlessly fascinating person.
Or he would just go on really long analyses of Viz comic strips. His favourite was The Drunken Bakers, which is a work of genius.
I can get all lyrical and carried away with the beauty of his writing. And he was also funny, you know. I was looking at his blog last night, and there was an article on there that he'd written called Rupert Bear and the Spatially Extended Nature of Regret. You know, it was so funny and playful, and I'm sorry there's not more of it.
The one that I suppose comes to my mind more readily is The Ghost of St. Paul, which was a song that Nick played every night as a kind of work in progress almost. When we were on tour together in 2010, and it's got a beautiful melody. It hints at other things. It encompasses a lot of different things that were totemic for Nick, you know, the kind of idea of documenting everyday things, almost like a link to the psychogeographical books that he might read, and that I suppose it also hints at personal struggles that we all have, and it does it with a kind of lyricism that converts it into the universal, which is the key to writing a song of that ilk.
This song is called The Ghost of St. Paul.
Just to hear some of the places that he obviously frequented as a resident of Bristol on that song, as well as its kind of haunting qualities, and hearing it every night and thinking, yeah, you know, this is going to be on a record one day, it's exciting to hear things before they're actually out, you know, all of those things combined mean that one sticks in my mind.
You're no friend of mine, though we're together,
most of the time. I say never again, with my hand on your door every day. One for the road and one for the city.
In December 2014, at the age of 37.
He was very much shaped by his circumstances and his resources, really, and I think he accepted that that was part of an artist's lot in life as well.
His music is really magical, and people will be listening to it for years to come.
The loss of a friend is immeasurable, but the loss of someone as an artist, for someone like Nick, is just the constant wondering of what would he have gone on to do. You know, what would Nick sound like in 5 years or 10 years?
If you're going to leave behind a series of albums as good as those, just lyrically, musically, everything about them is on another level. I can't think of British songwriters that can deal with the subjects he wrote about and do it in such a sort of eloquent, affecting way.
Somebody who captured something that is almost impossible to put down. He captured the kind of fragility and tenderness of the human experience in a way that it's incredibly difficult to do. And I will remember that. I will remember his talent and his humanity, which I think shines through in his music.
Nick had such a good brain and such a big heart. And I often think that when you get those two things together, it can be quite difficult to live with, you know, a good brain and a big heart. It's a lot. He channeled that into some astonishingly beautiful music and writing.
Abiding memory, I guess, was the last time I saw him, which was at the Sonic Cathedral 10th birthday party, which was Slow Dive's first gig for 20 years. They did a secret warm-up show for their Nick. Came up from Bristol on the Megabus. I just remember him down the front with a massive backpack on, which every time he moved around was whacking people and literally like tears streaming down his face. And then after they finished, he sort of came over, gave me a hug and scarpered back to Bristol.
You've been listening to Hourglass, a tribute to Nick Talbot, and you heard from Adam Burrows, Susie Gage, Sam Wistanoff, Nathaniel Cramp, Jeffrey Alexander, Paul Smith, Sophie Harris, Ali Chant, Julian Owen, Phil Rickman, Jeff Johns, Kit McKenzie, Lauren Laverne, Gideon Coe, Rich Radford, Rob Barneville, Kit Thomas, James Burton, Rachel Lancaster, and Claire Adams. My thanks to Mike Darby, Guy Bartell, and Robin Allender. Nick's blog and quotes were read by Maya Bosworth and Becky Ripley, and huge gratitude goes out to Nick's family and to Michelle Hilborn. This programme was produced by Richard Pitt and Toby Field, and we'll leave Nick with the final word.
That kind of stuff, you know, which is in many ways the whole point of having a Gibson Les Paul, is so that you can do that with a massive Marshall stack. That's Slash, isn't it? That's Jimmy Page. It's what really is what we all want to do.